idea that you are sharing this as much as possible. And to Jim's point earlier, you know, this is, we're sort of saying choose your battles right now. That, you know, we're not saying pop the kids in front of the TV all day long, but if you need to do that for an hour or two so you can do something or whatever has to happen, that's okay in the big picture, because the big things are getting done, hopefully, and that is, you know, they're getting to sleep, they're eating, they're getting some physical activity, they're getting some schoolwork done. This is, as Jen said earlier, I think it's just, you know, a great way to phrase this. This is a once-in-a-millennium kind of thing, not millennium, once-in-a-century kind of thing, and this is an exceptional circumstance, and we're fiddling our way through it, and this is not going to be the best year of learning for a lot of kids academically, but that doesn't mean it won't be the best year of learning they've ever had. Think about how much our kids don't get to engage in the natural world. And I think that one of the big problems we've seen in the last couple of decades, and it's become clear to us, is we've become more restrictive as parents and more directive in terms of kids being successful academically. We've pulled them out of playing in the mud. And there's so much great stuff that happens when you sit in the mud and play with the worms and you just, you know, kind of crawl around in the ground and you take your bike down the road and you just disappear into the woods. So there's a lot of opportunity here in certain settings and certain places for parents to give kids some of that kind of learning. And maybe you can feel okay about that and not have to feel like it has to be all academic right now.
Right, and I want to do just the flip side, Katie. I will tell you that if you feel that trying to divide the education causes even more tension and that kids are exposed to the tension between you and their dad, that may be worse than you taking it on. It sounds like you kind of know how to structure it, and if it isn't a negative thing and you want to do it that way, there's nothing wrong with it. It's about what works within the family. We like both parents to be responsible, but again, you have to measure kind of the level of conflict and what keeps things going in these times. So, Katie, I hope that was helpful. Thank you for giving us a call this morning. You're listening to Sirius XM 110, Dr. Radio, about our kids. We can be reached at 1-877-NYU-DOCS. That's 1-877-698-3627. If you have questions about maybe how to organize, if you have specific questions for Jen, what we'd like to get into is maybe you have those teens or older kids who, quote, should be doing it more on their own, should be more structured in their parents' mind. Jen, we'd love to hear your thoughts about that, or give us a call. So Jen, help us out. So you have older kids who we think really should be able to, like, go to school, do their homework. What do you think?
Yeah, and again, it does come down to not where they should be, mm-hmm. but where they are. And so, yeah, if your kids are, you know, the first caller, if they're much younger, but happen to be incredibly independent.
Yes.
If you have those super kids, congratulations, and you don't need to do anything, that's fine. But if you have an older kid who's struggling, this actually, again, is a really good opportunity, because it won't be too long before they're on their own in college, and these problems can really magnify. So talking about it, trying to work with them about it, this is a great time to do that. It's approached differently when they're older, and particularly if they're seniors, they're getting really close to being independent adults. But you can sort of come at it in a Socratic-like way. Just, you know, sit down, not right after something has happened, after they've made a big mistake, or, you know, that an assignment went in late, but just at a neutral time. Again, if you happen to be someone who struggles with your own organizational problems, bringing that into it, just saying, listen, this is something that I've struggled with in my life, and I notice, you know, that sometimes you're getting really stressed out, you're staying up really late, and it seems like it's really affecting you. And if we talk about it, we just want to talk about it and see if we can come up with solutions. I really want to try to get them to be more the engineers of helping to create a plan, and then you to be there to really support, offer suggestions, and structure that plan for them in as much as they need. And depending on the age, sometimes you can still get reinforcers in there to help them. So if you have an early high school kid, you know, if you're still limiting their screen time, things like that, then you can make specific organizational goals for them each day. And as they achieve them, they earn different things on their list, which can be really helpful. But I think the key thing for older kids is really making them a partner in the process.
Right, and what I hear you saying, Jen, is that even for adolescents, there may be usefulness in putting in rewards.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and Jess, what do you think about that? Even for your kids who are college age, you know, for your son, would you still use rewards? What do you think?
Absolutely. Rewards are perfect. I like rewards myself. We do it all the time, right? This is part of our organizational skills. If I get my work done, I can do something fun. First work, then play. Works perfectly. So the same thing with my son. You know, whatever he's looking for, whatever he wants, whatever he's engaged in, as long as it's healthy and safe and not overly indulgent, I'm not bribing, but I'm rewarding. So I'm giving on the back end, not the front end. You got to work for it. Or you give a tease and then you work for it and get the rest. I think that that's the way to go. And it's not, it sounds terrible when I say it that way, but it's really just natural human behavioral modification.
Not only that, I will talk to you about a group of medical doctors and PhDs that we have, over 100 of them working at the Child Study Center. And when we write our notes on time, our medical director, Jen, is laughing. But because we get, literally, if our notes are in on time, we get a star.
And I'm telling you,
and it matters so much. Like yesterday, my computer crashed and I couldn't open it. And I'm like, I'm not going to get my star. And I wanted to finish my notes. The star means nothing. We don't get a bonus. We don't get time off. We don't get, and if you don't get your star, it's not like I've gotten fired yet. You know, so.